After their visit to Mr. Choate, Josephine Goldmark and Florence Kelly left for Boston to visit Louis Brandeis at his home to ask him to take the case. While the ruling by the Oregon Supreme Court upheld the hour statute, the specter of the U.S. Supreme Court's precedent loomed large, and Ritchie remained an obstacle. April 29th, 2012, the day after, gray, rainy, italics for direct first-person voice, the direct quotes from a printed source are once more removed and need another style of presentation. These are the words which have come down to us. How to judge the truthfulness or even the simple factual accuracy of any statement from the past. The statements regarding thoughts or feelings or even the holding of opinions are unknowable, even if written down. At the time, they existed as a dialogue in a heart or mind. Yet, there is something called the ring of truth, which can be heard in these accounts. Louis Brandeis had become radicalized in 1892 by Mary Kenney's description of the armed violence between steelworkers and management in Homestead, Pennsylvania, near Pittsburgh, when Andrew Carnegie decided not to renew his company's contract with the steelworkers and refused to deal with the union. Mary Kenney, the same woman who was Florence Kelly's colleague at Hull House, traveled to the scene and later described to Brandeis the wall with apertures for guns that the company had mounted around the mill. The contract expired. Wages were slashed. The steelworkers went on strike. Henry Clay Frick, the company manager, hired Pinkerton guards and sailed up the Ohio River to protect the strikebreakers who had been hired by the company.